Good morning, Australia, and good afternoon to the Canadians. And I guess anybody else that's joining us as well. So I'm sure there are some other people that might be joining us from other parts of the world. So we are here with Robin from Canada Bird School, previously Calgary Bird School. I noticed that change, Robin. That's cool. I like that. Just encompassing a bit more of your country. So Robin joined us last year to talk about harness training, and the last 12 months has flown by, so I thought I'd get her on again to have a chat about something else. How are you going, Robin?
We're doing great. We're here in Canadian summer, so we're sweating a little bit. You guys are in Australian winter.
Yes.
Yeah, we're here. Calgary Bird School has helped people across Canada and in the States for a while, so we thought instead of continually explaining that Calgary is able to service the whole country, let's just go with Canada Bird School. We help a lot of people all over, and the more we can help, the better. So here we are in Australia, and we're going to have a little chat about Velcro birds. I'm really excited.
Yes. Yep. Yeah. So we got, so a couple of weeks ago, I put up a little post saying basically, you know, what are your big bird problems at the moment, so that we could start planning some more live Facebooks like this around what our membership and what our, you know, kind of clientele might be struggling with, and noticed a pattern where there were a lot of problems that seemed to be related to birds that were a bit Velcro to their humans, or one person bird problems where the birds kind of attached themselves to one particular person in the house and is having, you know, a variety of issues that kind of relate to that. And those, you know, even one person birds, Velcro birds, they kind of fall under the same heading, and they're, you know, a lot of the things that we can do will help in both of those situations, as well as help as a variety of other situations as well. So, you know, you've got a bird that screams a lot. What we talk about today is going to assist with that. You've got a bird that is destroying your, you know, curtain rods or the tops of your doors, then this is probably going to help with that as well. So this particular topic kind of covers a lot of those areas.
I think we should start with what is commonly termed a Velcro bird, because that's something that might mean different things to different people. And one person's idea of their bird being Velcroed to them might physically be a bird so close to them they can't even get them off their shirt, while another person's version of Velcro bird might be something totally different. So I think you're right. We're going to talk about a lot of different topics here. Let's start with sort of the idea of the Velcro being a label that will mean different things to different people. So we're going to talk about those birds who seem to be really needing that one-on-one, right in your face attention, whether it's physically on you or on your shoulder or on the sofa with you, or you can't even go to the bathroom without them coming down the hall, knocking on the door. That sort of 2-year-old toddler in bird form. It can be really different depending on the bird, and different if your bird is flighted or if your bird is small enough to get in your shirt or a big macaw. So we've got a lot of different options there with Velcro birds. So
yeah, and I think that's really important. Obviously, you know, yourself and myself, coming from a behavior background, we understand that labels are just that, they're a label. They don't, you know, they can mean many different things, but it's really important to operationalize these behaviors in observable terms, so we know exactly what we're looking at. Because yes, what one person considers a Velcro bird might be totally different to what somebody else does. And sometimes, in some cases, that may mean a difference in how we approach working with that bird as well.
Absolutely. These solutions that we're giving may be really specific to certain situations. I like to explain it like baking a cake. If I tell you how to bake a chocolate cake, I'm telling you how to bake a chocolate cake, and only a chocolate cake. And if you need a gluten-free cake, then you have to make your own substitutions to make it fit for your situation. I'm only going to teach you the one chocolate cake. So each of these solutions that we're suggesting may only work in certain situations for certain birds for certain reasons. So let's take it as a sort of overreach. We're going to give some broad ideas. We're going to get that motor going so you can think of fun new games to play with your bird to encourage some of that independent play or ambient play, like you can see behind me. Yes. But not necessarily 100% solve everyone's problem today.
Just get those we could.
I know.
Wouldn't that be nice?
That'd be lovely.
Just wave that wand.
I'm not going to bake all the cakes. We're just going to do a couple of cakes.
Yes, yeah. So before we started the live, you were telling me about a client with a preconceived notion of what they needed to do with their bird. So maybe you can walk us through that one.
Sure. Yeah. I think there is a common view that birds are fairly challenging to keep, and I like that. I think it's accurate. But this client had the idea that she needed to be home 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. She had to work from home. The bird needed so much attention, but she needed to be there with the bird all the time forever. And not doing that would be a disservice to the bird, like you shouldn't even get one. So she got this bird as a rescue, which is wonderful, and had that solid intention of spending as much time as possible with the bird. Yeah. Not really understanding that the bird may need time to nap or may need time to go play or do things independently. And that sort of ambient being in the same room but doing independent things was a new idea to her. So she is now able to, you know, walk to the next room, do a couple of things without having the bird directly on her. And she went, wow, really? That is so different from what I've heard online, where I need to be with this bird 24/7. So I really love her attention to detail. I love that she really wants to be there for that bird. I love that she's got this rescue bird like top and foremost in her mind. But yeah. I think part of that is also understanding that they're in a flock together, and maybe you're part of that flock. My African Gray is behind me. He's sitting on a Boeing. We're here. We're doing it together. But he's not really on me right now. This is sort of ambient attention. He's doing his thing. I'm doing my thing. We're in the same area. That really changed her outlook on keeping her bird and keeping her bird happy and healthy and being able to provide what that bird needed without necessarily having to be in each other's face 24 hours a day all the time. And I think that's a really good point. Let's give them great attention, but let's also let them be birds and have different types of attention. So yes. I like to break it up into that one-on-one attention where you're right there and right interacting one-on-one. That's great. And then maybe ambient attention where the bird is in their cage or on a safe play gym or a Boeing and in the same room where you're able to communicate. You can watch their body language. You can have a verbal interaction back and forth. They can be totally independent, like preening and sleeping and doing whatever it is Quinn's doing behind me. And then there's also totally independent where they're in the next room, away, maybe you're at work. To me, those three distinctions are really important. Do you have any other distinctions? Are there any other types of attention that you use?
Yeah, so I guess you've kind of covered it off, I guess. I live in a, you know, I work from home as well. So it can be really challenging when you work from home to recognize that, like, that doesn't mean that you have to spend all day going and giving them attention. And even I find that a struggle sometimes. You know, I might come down here to my office and sit down and be like, oh, you know, maybe I should go and play with a bird or get a bird out or have a bird behind me on a stand. But, you know, I do think that you probably covered off on like the three like main types of human attention separation, which is like that one-on-one, you're there, you're actively engaging with your parrot in that moment, versus the ambient attention. I love that term of like you're in the same space as the bird. Maybe they're on a play stand, maybe they're in a cage, but they're not, you know, they're not directly interacting with you. And maybe occasionally in that setup, you are then, you know, going over and interacting with them for a few moments before then going back to what you're doing. And then the, you know, yes, I have to leave the house or I have to go somewhere else and leave you alone. And I think it's important to make sure that we recognize that from the get-go, because some of the issues that we see come from that, you know, just bought a new bird home, whether it's a rescue bird or whether it's a baby bird, and people are obsessed with spending time with their bird, which is wonderful. But then we potentially create an issue with the bird doesn't know how to be alone because we're spending so much time with them and they're right around everywhere in the house on our shoulder. And I think there's a difference. I will say that I believe there's a difference between I'm at the other end of the house away from you versus I'm out of the house, because most birds are pretty good at like knowing when you're still home versus when you've left the environment altogether. And so, you know, often we'll get complaints about birds that engage in, say, screaming behavior when people are home but not with the bird, versus the bird is very quiet when they're out of the house. And so I think it's important to make sure that you're not just training the bird to be alone when you've left the house, but that the bird is also learning to be alone when you are in the house, because otherwise you do end up with an issue where the bird screams from the other end of the house every time you leave. And that's obviously a big problem for many people, especially now that so many of us have been working from home. During the COVID outbreak, you know, we got a lot of complaints during work from home periods last year about excessively noisy birds, because they hadn't really ever had to survive with people in the house at the same time, but being in their cage. And so people are trying to work from home and they've got a bird that's just screeching the house down because it doesn't know how to function in that setup.
I think that's a really good point. And there's so many dynamic changes with working from home and having to work out of the house, and then all the changes in routine because we're not doing our normal 9 to 5, or we don't have the coming and going, or your partner doesn't have the normal coming and going. I know my partner's been home a lot or away a lot, like away for a week at a time, which is again a different thing. So all of those changes change up those routines. That's a thing. But birds are resilient and adaptable and totally brilliant, and we can work with that. We just have to remember to set them up so that they can be successful. Yeah. I think that a lot of this is flipping the question. We do this a lot in the bird school. What do you want them to do?
Yes.
How do you want them to spend their day? Yeah. How are we going to set them up so this is going to be the right thing for them? And if I can set up the environment so the cage is in the main room, or I can set it up so that there are environment changes that make it really easy. I'm sitting behind me, he doesn't care. He's hanging out, we're hanging out, we're good. Or do I have him in the next room with the door closed and he is having behavior problems, screaming and whatnot. So let's start with setup, because I think setup is the easy answer.
Setup, yes, absolutely.
Changing the environment, moving the cage, adding a play gym, adding a situation that makes it so easy for your bird that they are going to succeed. So if you have a bird that is so attached to you that they're physically on you, then we can't expect them to go across the room and be happy either. So let's just set it up. Let's start with setup, because I find them to be super easy. Easy on the bird, easy on the human, and do a lot of really good before we get into training or teaching.
I love that. Yeah, absolutely. And I think that often when I walk into a house where I'm seeing issues that relate to the bird being Velcro label, that often, you know, what I see initially is that the environment maybe isn't set up in a way that encourages different behavior. So I definitely, it's often the first part that I have to address. And like just looking at like your environment right now is that you have this wonderful rope buoying that's hanging up behind you. I can't, like, it's a bit, you know, kind of far away, but I can see that it's got some toys hanging off it, and it's interesting, and it's up nice and high, so it's not low to the ground. It's not at shoulder height, it's above you, which people are often really wary of doing because of other misinformation in the world, Facebook land and everywhere, and even, Facebook land in, from other professionals that, within different areas. So, you know, I like that because that's one of the first things that is kind of important to set up, is to go, you know, what's going to encourage my bird to spend time in this space. You know, a lot of people I meet want, you know, they're like, well, my bird comes to the office with me, but then when we look at the office set up, there's nowhere for the bird to hang out, or it's like just a stand with a dowel perch on it.
Yeah.
And it's about the same height as you sitting down. And so, of course, the bird is kind of coming over and spending time on the person because that's way more interesting. So
I love having a perch in every room. All of my birds are flighted. A lot of my clients have flighted birds. When you're going to a new room, they have the ability to follow you, which I love. But that is just it. I got to set it up so that he can come with me, not just because he's going to, but it's going to be best for us as a flock to move together. Let's go to the next room. Here's my chair. Here's your chair. This is where I want you to hang out. Here's some fun things for you to do. This is going to keep you entertained. You're allowed to eat there. You're allowed to poop there. This is your spot. Set them up. Set them up for success.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a big thing. That environmental setup, those antecedent arrangements are such a big part of it, because we've got a question here that said, Steve said he's got a macaw and she will often fly to him uncued, and he wants to know, you know, do I catch her and put her straight back, only letting her stay on me longer if I call her, or should I not catch her unless she's cued? He doesn't want to dodge and weave when his bird comes flying at him, which is, yeah, I totally understand that as well. And dodging and weaving when your bird flies at you can make you untrustworthy as well. So it's not necessarily the behavior we want to engage in or the relationship we want to have with our bird. And I think the answer to that is often, instead of thinking in terms of what do I do when my bird fails, we want to think in terms of how do I make it so my bird is less likely to fail in the first place. And when I say fail, again, that's kind of a label. Obviously, in the bird's head, they're not failing at anything. They're getting exactly what they wanted. They're doing a behavior that's been reinforced in the past. But, you know, let's label the, you know, not doing what the human wants them to do as a fail, you know, and think in terms of, yeah, how do we set the bird up for success? How do we make it less likely that she's going to engage in that behavior? And some of that is that antecedent arrangement, that environmental setup, making it so she wants to spend more time on those perches and that setup that you've got at home. So,
I guess that's the next question for that person is, why would the bird need to fly to you? Aren't they busy? Don't they have lots of stuff to do over there? Isn't it super fun over there? Don't they have so much going on that they're like, hey, I got stuff to do. Could you come back later?
Yeah.
Or are you working on that flying thing? And so right now it's sort of the behavior du jour, and that's the thing that they're doing because that's that top of mind behavior. That's sort of what I'm thinking. And so we have sort of a stimulus control issue, which is fine, especially young birds love to do the new thing. Let's do the new thing all day, every day. Yeah. I probably suggest cueing different perches and giving them names and making it a fun game. If she's got energy and she's flying, okay, great. So you landed on me, I'm cued, who cares? Go chair, go living room, go sofa, go tea stand.
Yeah.
Come. Awesome. Yeah. Here's your treat. Now I can put you on the stand and we can station properly. I think there's so many opportunities there to say, okay, she's flying to you uncued. That's just information. All right. Let's use that information instead of, I don't really want her to do that. Let's tell her what we do want and then help her when she's done her flying to all those different named perches. Where do we want her to hang out? Okay, you're going to hang out right here. Here's all the fun stuff. Good job. So let's segue this one into, how do I keep my bird on a play stand?
Yeah, and I'm just going to really quickly say, you should be able to add photos to the comment section, and I've got Facebook open so I can actually see those. So I was going to encourage you, if you're at home and you're asking questions of us about this, you know, if you've got a chance to get a photo of those play stand setups and those play area setups that you have for your birds, pop those in the comments, because I can then bring them up onto the screen here as well, and we can go, hey, maybe we can change this or do this or make this more exciting in this way. And we can give you tips based on what you've, what your setup is as well. So feel free to pop some photos in the comments there if you've got an opportunity to do it. And at some stage I might go for a walk and also show you what I ended up building for my birds, because I I had to think in terms of I don't want my birds to be landing on the cages that are inside the same room that we spend a lot of time in. So I'll do that as well. But yeah, let's segue into that. Hey, how do we actually train our bird to spend time not just sitting on a stand waiting for us to come back and reinforce them, but actually engaging with toys and activities on their stand? Because that's the big one as well. Like, we can spend time teaching the bird a wait behavior where, you know, we walk away and we come back and we reinforce for staying on the perch, but that's not necessarily what we want. Like, you know, it can be helpful to utilize that positive reinforcement training as part of the plan, but we also want the bird to spend time there, not staring at us waiting for us to come back and give them a treat for waiting.
two pieces to the same puzzle, for sure. If we are working on making the stand fun, that's where the bird's going to hang out, because it's the best spot in the entire room. It's got all the fun toys, it's got all the things hidden, it's new, it's fresh, it's exciting, it's the spot to be. And I will sometimes pack fun new things into the stand before I let everyone out, so that they're going to explore all those stations. It's like, lady, give me a minute. I'm busy here. I got to go and check out all these things rather than find me directly, which is awesome. It's great to give them something to do. But if your attention is the most reinforcing thing, then we go back to setup. I want that stand to actually be within arm's reach, so the bird doesn't even fly to get attention. We're setting it up so that they don't even need to do the problem behavior in the first place. I have a lot of stands on wheels, and I will bring that thing right over, wheel it right over, so that that bird can get as much attention as I can give, and will slowly move that stand further and further away as the bird understands that it's a fun spot. I'm still right here. It's okay. Yeah. Super fun spot. I'm still right here.
I'm right here. Yeah. And I think this is where people get stuck. And sometimes, we feel guilty when we have to leave them in a cage for the day. We've got to go to work. We feel guilty. They're in a cage. So most people focus their foraging activities for the day around the bird being in the cage. And then so they give, new toys, foraging activities, all of that interesting stuff inside the cage. Then when we get home, we let the bird out and we give them nothing new, because we've already given them all of that in the cage. And so we are the only interesting thing for that bird to do then. And so I think some of it's reframing how we, how we set the bird's routine up as well.
That's huge.
Yeah, spread that foraging out. One baffle cage, if your bird's good at a baffle cage, it may just have one treat right in the center. And your bird just has to spend however much time pulling everything out to get to that one fantastic treat in the center. Don't do that if you've never done a baffle cage before. You've got to work towards that. But, if your bird is good at foraging, then you don't need to pack all of their food into the same foraging toy. You might spread it out over many foraging toys so that, they can have some while you're out of the house for the day. But then when you get home, there's also some fun, interesting things that you can put on their play areas. And I think that's a big part of it, is that I'm guilty of it as well. I'm like, oh, I've got a busy day tomorrow. I know that I'm not going to get to spend as much time with my birds. They're going to be in their cages or their aviaries, make a bunch of foraging stuff. And then I have to, retrain myself. Don't put it all in right now. Save some of that for when you do have them out. So, if a day's so busy that I'm only going to get, a little bit of time with each of them, then maybe I won't worry, because the time that I do spend with them is active. It's training, it's, playing a game together, it's flying around. But if I, if I've got enough time, then I want them to do other things when they're out of their cage, because I often have things I need to do as well. If I've had a busy day, I can't just spend 4 hours looking after my birds. I've got to cook dinner and look after the dog and you know, everything else. So,
reserve a few things. It's not that I'm not giving it to them. I'm just saving them for when I need them. Exactly. For example, the bathing dish. Some birds have a bathing dish all time forever, and that's their thing. That's fine. I prefer to reserve the bathing dish and offer it and say, here, for the next hour, it's bath time. You've got the dish. It's out in your stand. Go ahead and bathe. I'm going to go make dinner. So I've just sort of saved it in reserve and then provided that opportunity. And now the bird's crazy busy. Doesn't need me at all. They're just going to do their bathing thing and I can go off, do whatever. Yeah. I have a special foraging bin that I save for when I need to call my mom. Because I'm going to be on the phone for half an hour.
Awesome.
This is for you. I'm going to be on the phone.
Yep. Bathing's a good one as well, because often, you know, there's obviously that time spent splashing around in the bowl and bathing and getting wet. But then there's also the period of time that comes after that where the bird is now settled and preening while they dry off. And so you get kind of a double dose there of like the bird doing things by themselves. So bathing's a good one if you've got a bird who enjoys bathing. So, or, you know, has a, I love that your birds obviously kind of, you put the bathing dish out and they're like, woo, it's bathing time.
It's an opportunity that they don't have all day, every day. It's also easier for me to keep clean because when I'm not there, they tend to soil the water. And I can come home and get everything all out and do all the fun things. We can do a spray mist for a bit. We can have all the flapping and crazy bathing. And that's a great bonding experience. And then, yeah, they do preen and they, you know, sit in the sunshine and fix all their feathers and shake it all off for a bit. Maybe they go back in again. It's a great opportunity to interact with your bird. It doesn't take away from anything else during their day. And I've just kept it in reserve for when I needed it. So it can be that simple.
I guess it's fresh
for after work.
Yeah. And I think sometimes, I guess it's kind of like when we talk about, oh, let's not put, you know, sunflower seed or pine nuts in their dish so we can use it as a reinforcer by kind of reserving that like bathing opportunity. And it's not like you're withholding it for weeks on end, you know, but by making it kind of a bit more special because they don't have access to it 24/7, which they wouldn't, you know, generally in the wild either. We can then make it a bit more special and they're more likely to do it then when we offer it. So we can offer it at times where we're like, oh, I, you know, need to go and do something. Let's keep my birds busy. Here's some, you know, here's a dish to bathe in. So it's not going to work for every bird because not every bird likes a bath. Does your African grey bath?
He likes a dish bath. He likes a shower in the human shower.
That's one way you can people complain a lot about African greys not particularly enjoying bathing time and being difficult. So
I got to get a video of it. He'll go for half an hour. He loves it. He'll bathe in the aviary. He'll bathe in the house. He's just, yeah, he's pretty good.
Sometimes it is just providing lots of opportunities to do it. So yes.
We'll do another one on bathing, okay?
Yeah. Yes. awesome. So that's, I think foraging activities are kind of a big part of it, at least in the early stages as well. So if you've got a bird that you're struggling to, you know, un-velcro from yourself, they're attached to you every time you let them out of their cage, reserving some of that foraging for when you have to have them out of the cage is a good first step. So we can, like, it sets us up for success. Then they're on their play stand, they're foraging, and then that gives us an opportunity to also actively reinforce doing something else. And that's another thing that I think it's really important to touch base on, is that we do this with kids and dogs and basically any other being we share our lives with. We tend to ignore them when they are doing the things that we want them to do. You know, they're on their play stand, they're doing their own thing, they're preening or they're bathing or they're foraging, and we're like, oh, shh, don't disturb them. I don't, you know, because we're worried that if we then go over and interact with them, that they're going to stop that and then get onto us. But the problem then is that they do that, they get zero attention from humans for being on their play stand and being a bird and playing on their own. And then they fly to us and they get attention. And so, you know, or they fly to our curtain rod and they start chewing on it and they get attention. or they get on our fan or, you know, whatever place that somebody doesn't want them to be. And we immediately then give them attention for that behavior. So the bird learns when I play on my play stand, I don't get anything from the humans. No attention, no nothing. When I do this behavior, that gets attention. They're not being naughty. They're just doing what they've learned in the environment. And so I think we need to also reframe how we're interacting with our birds when they are playing independently. Don't ignore them. Go over there and interact with them. Make it so that that's the thing that gets your attention, rather than the things you don't want them to do.
Well, and attention is a big reinforcer. And we forget to mention it as a reinforcer because we're all about the nut or the seed or the thing that you can give them or the foraging thing that you can hide. And you forget that your attention, your beautiful face is what they want to see. And I'll actually ask people to go and play with their bird with the bird toy. This is something that is going to be reinforcing because your face is part of it. That is what they're looking for, that attention. You never play with the bells. You never give them attention for playing with the bells. Let's flip that around. You go, you play with the cardboard. You tear it up a little bit. You shake the toy around. You fiddle with the thing with your bird. We get past the neophobia because now we're part of the flock, and neophobia is all about what's new and scary. Nobody else is touching it. So we've got past that, and we're reinforcing with the attention that your bird really wants. I think it's just a lovely, beautiful answer. When we're worried about Velcro birds and trying to remove the tumor, why don't we just use that to our advantage and insert a toy that we can then foster that play with? I think it's a really underused reinforcement opportunity. Your attention's huge, huge. Your bird loves you. That's why he's a Velcro bird. So let's use that to our advantage and give him that attention for doing the stuff that we really want him to do.
Yeah, I really like that as well because, often people think of it in terms of like, I don't want my bird to be on me. I want them to be on their play stand. But often, especially when the bird has this really long history of coming to you and sitting on you and playing, like, you know, just being with you, there has to be those small approximations towards that end goal. You can't just go from the bird spending hours sitting on your shoulder to the bird spending hours sitting on a play stand. We need to break that down into those small approximations like we would with any behavior. And so that might be, let's just play with toys on the human to start off with. And with you interacting with that toy as well, because yes, like play is a lot more fun when you've got someone else to play with. And our attention is such a huge part of why they spend so much time on us in the first place. We need to then teach them that you can get attention from us for other behavior. So yeah, bring the toys to the bird to start off with and then work towards getting the bird off you to play with the toys.
Oh, it works so well. It's so amazing to get that attention as a reinforcer instead of the nut as the reinforcer. And then we've got a bird that's here with a toy and then maybe in your lap with a toy and then maybe on the edge of the sofa with the toy. And we can just grow that independent play and still have it work for the bird. That way we're not fighting each other. Let's use it and work together on it. Your bird loves you. That's awesome. Let's use that.
Yes. Yep. Absolutely. So I had something and now my brain has dropped it out somewhere.
The sheet we did, the six other ways of playing with your bird. If you got 5 minutes, let's play with your bird.
You talk and I'll pull it up because I've got it here somewhere.
We'll bring it up here. The idea is we are kind of busy in our lives and maybe you do only have 5 minutes with your bird. And what are the ways that we could spend 5 minutes one-on-one? Let's really define what that one-on-one looks like. So then when we move to ambient, there's a separation there. So one-on-one play might be training specifically. Let's play target. Great fun game. It can be 5 or 10 reps and then you're done. 5 minutes, you're done. Off you go. Here's a bunch of other stuff to do. But you've got that one-on-one time together. So I did up for the Canada Bird School, but also for everyone. Please take this and share it freely. If you've got 5 minutes with your bird, here's a bunch of options. Pick one, do one. Or even better, pick one at a time. Do all six, but at different times during the day. You've got 5 minutes, do the first one. You got 5 minutes, do the third one. You got 5 minutes, do the fourth one. Awesome. Sprinkle it in. Almost.
There we go.
Yeah, oh, that's the socialization checklist.
Oh,
it looks the same. You got that too?
Hold on, I'll scroll down.
Socialization, keep going, socializing. Mm-hmm. 5 minutes with your bird, there we are.
Perfect, there we are.
Big image, big. Okay, you got 5 minutes. So first option, you could play with them. So depending on your bird, some birds really like peekaboo or kisses. If you've got a kayak, he'll probably surf. If you've got a cockatoo, he'll probably throw things. But whatever it is your bird does, go play with your bird. Interact with him. Ring the bell with him. Play.
Yep.
Love it. Just do something that your bird knows. Yep. I added in the next one, which is slow down, because we often forget to sit with our birds and just chill. It's always go, 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 go. So yep. Do some head rubs. If your bird is into head rubs at that particular moment, always ask. Snuggle together if you like, or if they don't want to be touched, just watch them preen, just sit, just chill.
Yeah.
Love the slow down.
Look out the window, because I used to, and so my eclectus coder, we'd like sit and watch the birds outside or whatever, and we'd talk about it. And so she does things like, you know, she'll go, where's the birds? You know, where's the birds? And then she'll go, birdie, 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 birdie. Because I just, like, we'd just sit and watch what was going on outside and talk about the birds that were outside. And so, you know, that was something that we did. Yeah, just watching what's going on out the window and talking about, you know, the people going past or the birds in the yard or whatever it happens to be. Yeah, it doesn't, like, it can be interaction where you're kind of just chilling together but having a conversation about life.
Yeah, it's super engaging. Yeah. All right. So we've got training. That's your do some target, do a wave, train some recall, like come here, something little, something quick, something your bird already knows. This isn't a brand new training session. This is just a couple of quick repetitions for fun. And your bird will enjoy it because you're going to use positive reinforcement and you're going to give them a reinforcer for each repetition. So super fun to do 5 minutes of training. Does not have to be a big, long school.
Nope.
Enrichment feeding, that's the foraging bowl, food dispensing toy, some sort of lighting that way.
I want to like point this out as well. Something that we think in terms of like enrichment feeding and foraging is like we give this to our bird to do on their own, but sometimes we can also like interact with them while they do that. And that can be, especially if your bird doesn't have a big history of foraging, or they don't seem that interested in it, we can make that behavior, that activity more fun for them and build up to longer periods of foraging and to more difficult foraging by actually doing it with them initially, rather than just going, here's something to do, bye.
Yeah. Playing with them, helping them, lifting the thing open with them, poking the little millet out a little further. Yeah. Help them tear the hole open. Yeah. And now they're getting the attention from you too. So that's double win. Love it. 5 minutes. Go ahead.
Yeah.
All right, so the next one is busy beaks. So something chewable, destroyable. I love helping my birds rip up something easy. Kleenex, wood, cardboard, tissue paper is easy. I use balsa with my African gray. It's okay. Something easy, fun, and shreddable. Let's just go to town.
Balsa's great. Balsa's really good. Like, you know, even with my macaws, sometimes I'll give them balsa bits like within the pine and stuff so that they've got that like there's just a level of like reinforcement in being able to crush something with that beak. And yeah, pine takes them longer, but it makes them work harder. And so getting that opportunity to have something that's easy for a moment can be really reinforcing. Mahogany pods are another really good one. They're pretty soft, but super fun for them to kind of tear into. So
yeah, love it. Yeah. Love it. Yeah. And then the last one here is one that is trickier for the humans than it is for the bird. It's called prize giving. So you're actually just noticing your bird doing something amazing without being told. Your bird is just doing it already on their own. And you go over and you give them some kisses or you give them a nut. Yes. Hey, I see you like my African gray behind me right now, hanging out on your boing for the last 40 minutes, being a really awesome bird. Aren't you amazing? I should probably go over there and just give him a little kiss just for being amazing.
Yeah, exactly.
You good? Yeah. Okay. I think he's good.
He's good.
That's the idea of prize giving, is it's not a cued do the wave.
Yes.
Catch them in the act of something you just really love. Good job doing that. Here's a prize for no reason other than you're being awesome right now.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's exactly kind of that, like, you know, like I said, kind of we tend to be in this like mindset of ignore the bird when they're being well behaved.
Yeah.
But what we want to do is more like that, where we're like, oh, look at what you're, oh my God, what are you foraging in that foraging tray? Oh, that looks like fun. You know, maybe, you know, poke around in it with them. Maybe you sneakily drop a little bit of a sunflower seed in there for them so that they eventually find it. But yeah, just using what they want the most, which is often our attention. That's why they're Velcroed to us all of the time, to reinforce that more desirable behavior. And that's, you know, something that's really important, as well as recognizing that in the moment, probably they're not looking for food. They're not flying to us. Sometimes they're flying to us for food. My macaws will fly to me and then be like, go to the fridge. No, you're not getting any treats right now, guys. But, you know, recognizing that what is the reinforcer in that environment at the moment, it might not be food. If they're flying to you, it's probably not food unless you're eating. If they're flying to you, it's attention. And so we want to make sure that, like, don't try and un-velcro your bird that's looking for attention with food. Un-velcro them with attention.
Yeah, absolutely. That's such a good point. That's the attention, what they're looking for. It's the function of the behavior, which is where we go to. Thank you, Dr. Friedman. What's the function? What's the function of that Velcro? They just love you so much. Awesome. Yeah. Then all we need to do is take that love and help the bird do a little bit more and give them that love so it maintains the same function.
That's it. Yeah. And I was just, I'm going to pull up another another little infographic in a moment. But
comments here. Let's see. Quiet when the house is empty, but loud when we are in the next room. That to me is a flocking thing. I love that my birds flock with me. And to be honest, I have had my bird fly away, and having him call to me when I wasn't right in front of him was really handy for helping me find him. Now, I never want to tell anyone to do that, but like, I'm actually okay with the contact call. I'd like to develop a good contact call so that doesn't bug me so much. But also now I have a stand or a gym or a tree in every room. That's the antecedent arrangement. So
that's it. And I think that's important as well. And it doesn't have to be that your bird is like screaming at you as a contact call. You can shape a desirable contact call. And, you know, like, so that just comes down to what we're reinforcing as well and teaching our birds, you know, a contact call that we like. So.
Let's see here. This is a great comment. I want to read it out. Ambient attention is the hardest for me, assuming the human. I always want to interact, and it takes actual thought and scheduling for me to ensure we practice that ambient. And that's a really good point, especially with a brand new bird, a baby bird, something that is extra precious to you for a whole number of reasons. You just want to love them so much. I have the same problem. I just want to snuggle them.
Yep.
But remember,
but that can't be all of our time.
It's not all the time, so that you can still love them. Like, I love him so much right now. I just want to snuffle under his under fluffies. Look at his cute little bum. And take a lot of pictures and share them on the Facebook. And you don't have to be right up in their face. But also reinforce yourself for making these things happen. Take those pictures, share them with us, and say, hey, look, my bird's doing that ambient thing. I love pictures of ambient play. Please send me lots of those pictures. And if you catch your bird doing that, send them all over to me, because I love sharing that the birds don't have to be all up in here. I want to see more independent play. Yeah, send it. Love it.
I actually got some photos yesterday from a client who was of exactly that. She's like, he's getting so much better at independent play. Like, we'd had a consult because her bird had just hit maturity and had started to decide that one of the other birds in the house might be his mate. And he was spending a lot of time just sitting on this other bird's cage. And so in this case, when we label a Velcro bird, this bird wasn't Velcroed to the human. He was Velcroed to another bird in the household. I don't think the other bird was particularly loved that he was sitting on her cage all of the time. But, so we had to really talk about, and some of it came down to also managing his, hormone flush as well, like hitting that first, adolescent stage, and he was on, his diet was a little bit too high in some carbohydrates and things. So we managed that and got him onto a better diet. And that's going to help, obviously, but also then working on encouraging him to spend time engaging in play somewhere else so that he wasn't Velcroed to where this other bird was, because it was causing issues where the client couldn't even do training with him because he was so, laser focused on want to be with that other bird. And that's a complaint we get often with birds that are going through a hormone flush. They laser focus on you're my mate, we're supposed to be doing this thing. And it can be really hard then to get the bird to focus on something else. It was just a couple of photos of him literally sitting on a play stand doing his own thing. It's like, yay.
When I got that, I climbed behind with an umbrella cockatoo, same thing. Stereotype of cockatoos being super cuddly, and we're working on helping this cockatoo find something fun to do. And so it was a picture of the cockatoo, like just tail feather sticking out of the play gym kind of thing. And I was so happy. Super engaging for that bird. Obviously busy. Didn't need you. Got stuff to do, Mom. I just love seeing birds engaged in natural, species-specific behaviors. It makes me so happy to see a bird being a bird.
Yep, absolutely. I agree. Some of you may have already seen this. I know it's quite far away just because it's long, but we did this infographic up a couple of weeks ago when someone asked about, do you have a handout on how to teach independent play? So I put this together. Obviously, it's, and it does cover off what we talked about today. So things like having a play stand too often, when I'm talking to clients, they'll have some stuff. The cage is interesting, and maybe on top of the cage is interesting. The bird has a play top, but they don't necessarily have anywhere else fun to hang out that's in the house. So they need spaces that are theirs. Otherwise, we can't expect them to just hang around on top of their cage all of the time. Just like last year, we all hated having to hang around in our own backyards. So our birds are the same. Don't make it so that the only fun spot for them to hang out is their cage or on top of their cage or, right next one perch that's next to their cage. Make it so they have fun spaces to hang out in different parts of the house, because that is, that's part of getting them to play independently. And make sure it's not just, we see a lot of stands that are, those metal stands with the one dowel perch on them with maybe a bowl, and it's like, oh, that's boring. And so that's why I particularly chose this one. This is a Java wood stand. They're expensive. You don't have to buy a Java wood stand. You can make your own stand out of safe timber. They're pretty easy to make. And if you make it yourself, you can, you know, you can replace the timber on a regular basis and make it interesting that way as well. Foraging. So, you know, making sure we're providing some of that foraging and enrichment activities on their play areas, not just in their cage. Yeah. Toy rotation, that's a big one as well. Often we'll just leave the same toys there for periods of time. And, you know, if we're not interacting with the bird with those toys, and often they're like, that's boring. You know, that toy, I played with that already yesterday and now it's kind of boring. But if we go back over there and we're like, what is this toy you've got? Oh my God. Oh. And, you know, you stick a few little bits of food in it so that they find them. Suddenly that toy is more fun again. Or we switch it out. So don't, you know, shove a bunch of toys on the play stand. Don't just put 50 toys on the play stand. Put 3 toys on the play stand and rotate them every couple of days. That's way more fun for your bird than having the same 50 toys just shoved on their play stand all of the time. And then, you know, active reinforcement of that behavior. An active reinforcement doesn't have to be food. It can be attention. So going over there and going, oh, my God, what are you playing with here? That looks like a lot of fun. Wow. Because they want attention. That's why they fly to you. That's why they fly to the curtain rods. Replace those behaviors with the one that you like and give them attention for that. Your bird may stop what they're doing in the early stages and be like, oh, hello, and climb up on you. It's not the end of the world. That's okay. We can work through that in those early stages. That's probably what's going to happen, but that's okay. Then you can like play with them for a bit and then cue them back onto the play stand, give them something to do, walk away again. So you can find that on our Facebook page and in this group as well, if you want to have a look at that in more detail, or, you know, share it, print it out, talk about it. It's there the same as Robin's little infographic.
Thank you.
Yeah. Cool. So much talking.
I know. Does anyone have a specific situation of Velcroing that they would like us to talk about here? And pop it in the comment section. Give us a minute to think about it. We'll pick one and we'll talk about it.
Yeah, yep. I also just wanted to, while we wait for maybe someone to kind of pop up, I also wanted to just stress, and we've already kind of covered off on it through the infographic that Robin has done and that, but like also focus on, in the early stages of maybe trying to un-velcro your bird, maybe you're focusing on lots of quality time with your bird when they're out of their cage rather than quantity. So not going, well, I need to have my bird out of the cage for 4 hours of the day, but focusing on, you know, maybe I've got 15 minutes right now, so I'm just going to go and do 5 minutes of training, 5 minutes of enrichment feeding, and 5 minutes of like, you know, talking about things outside the window. Then I'm going to have to put my bird back in the cage again for a little while because I know that they're going to otherwise kind of Velcro to me. And I need to do other things. And then maybe an hour or two later, you come back and you're like, oh, I've got another 15 or 20 minutes, do some more quality activities with them, rather than focusing on, I need to have my bird out for 4 hours straight. And sometimes we do that. We get into this mindset of, the bird needs to be out for this many hours all together at the same time. And that's not necessarily the case. And most birds are going to be happier and have better welfare if they're getting short periods of active engagement with you rather than long periods of just riding around on your shoulder. Sorry.
I think that's a really good comment. It's something that we don't talk about very much is sort of the day clock. What's a bird supposed to do all day? How do we divide up the day into bird activities? And the bird wakes up in the morning and then what? Do we have playtime? And then there's breakfast, and then there's sit and preen for a bit, and then there's play with the toys, and then there's lunch. They might go down and, you know, destroy a specific toy. My guys usually have a nap about 2 o'clock, which is also the 2 o'clock chattiest chatter time. I don't know why 2 o'clock is always chatter time, but it is. And then they have a nap. And then it sort of wake up, destroy something else. Maybe there's a preen in there. I come home from work. Then we'll have some play. We'll do a chop in my house. We have some sort of fresh food. There's a dinner, very social. We'll do a little bit of training. Then they're off preening again. Then they do this sort of like ambient preen bird things.
Yeah.
And then we're bedtime, but there's a lot of different things in a day. So it doesn't all have to be, like you said, 4 hours. I have to give my bird all of this attention right now. They've got other things that they should be filling their day with, and napping and preening and eating and chewing and screaming and all of these normal bird things all have to have their time during the day.
Yeah.
And let that be okay.
Yes. Yeah, I agree. Yeah, we do. And I think some of it comes down to we inadvertently teach birds at a young age to spend a lot of time on us. And then just because we're doing that, because we love them and they're cute and they're cuddly, especially those baby birds when we get them as babies, we tend to, over cuddle them and let them ride around on us a little bit too much. And all of those natural behaviors, they just fall away because the bird doesn't do them. And so they fall away, they stop having any kind of reinforcement value, and the bird stops being a bird. And so it's super important when we get young birds, especially in our homes, that we immediately off the bat recognize that we just can't sit and cuddle them all of the time. We need to give them opportunities to bird, because otherwise those behaviors will extinguish. And that can then lead to, it's like, you know, aside from the Velcroing and codependency, it can also lead to other issues, because then they fill that time up with other with kind of a repetitive behavior. And that's something that we don't want either.
It should be a good mix throughout the day of all of those natural species specific behaviors, all at different times.
Yeah. Yep. Yep, exactly. Maria said, my blue and gold macaw is always on me, and if I try to get her off, she gets aggressive 70% of the time. And when she is on me, she enjoys trying to munch on me. This is a complaint that I get really often. I went out and saw a client for exactly this problem yesterday. And, you know, it is something that I get, I guess, complaints about on a regular basis. Like, my bird will be sitting on me and they'll sit there for a few minutes and then they start biting me, or they start. And this is one of the problems with having a bird that spends a lot of time on you, because they're just sitting on you. As we start focusing on something else, we pick our phone up, we start playing with it, we watch TV, we're talking to someone else. The bird goes, hey. And we're like, ow, don't do that. And they're like, huh. This gets your attention. And then we start to train our birds, when we're not paying attention to them, bite me, because it gets my attention. And so we do end up with birds that will bite to get attention.
Attention to the enforcer. That's the thing.
Yeah.
And what would you like your bird to do?
Yeah. And just to clarify also, people are like, oh, but I say no, or put my finger in the bird's face and say, uh-uh. And it's like, it doesn't matter. Any attention is good attention when you want attention. Yeah. And so don't think in terms of, oh, I say no, though. And or the other option is people go, get off me. And they shove, push their bird off and put them in the cage or whatever. And then we end up with biting hands, because hands become the thing that push them away or put them in a cage. And so we get it stuck in this cycle of biting and conflict with our animals. So this is where that, you know, with a bird that has gotten into this cycle, I'd be like, okay, cool. Now when we're out of the cage, it's that quality time. We're spending quality time engaging our bird in activities so that they're not just sitting on us, so that they don't get the opportunity to do the biting. And so we break that cycle. So then when I get my bird out, I'm like, okay, we've got activities to do. We're going to do these activities together. We're going to play together, et cetera, et cetera. And then maybe I'll pop you back away for a little while. They don't get to spend the time there anymore. And then the other thing that I recommend is, if you are going to do some, like, hey, let's chill out together, I'll have toys with me that I can direct their beak to. So I'm like, hey, instead of chewing on my fingers, chew on this toy instead. And I'll play, like, and people are like, oh, but I give him a toy and he just drops it. And that's because you're just giving it to him. You're not playing with it with them. So, yeah. Robin, anything to add to that?
That's exactly what I would say. Exactly. Absolutely. Let's structure it a little bit more so that when the bird is with you, it's totally awesome. I love your bird to be with you, but we're going to set the timer for 15 minutes. We're going to do specific things for 15 minutes. They can absolutely be with you, but we're doing things on purpose so that they don't get that, hey, lady, pay attention to me thing.
It is so much like that, isn't it? It's like the bird version of clicking, hey.
And when they're here, we're going to be really actively engaging in what we want the behavior to look like. I want you to chew on this toy. I'm going to play wrestle with you. I'm going to help you tear the Kleenex apart. We're going to take this pine cone apart piece by piece together. Awesome. If we're not doing this together, then you are put away in your cage and we can do some work through the cage. But otherwise, we really need to focus that attention to the things that we want to see. And I like to throw this in here, not that I'm trying to be fatalistic, but if anything should happen to you, I want that bird to be able to interact nicely with the next person who needs to be its caregiver. And just because you are okay with this bird right here nibbling on your ear for 4 hours straight doesn't mean that me, as the person who's going to be the next caregiver, is going to be able to provide that. So let's give our birds the skills. Let's teach them some of these really cool ways of interacting, like toys or shredding newspaper, that is a little bit more accepted and will help your bird in the long run. God forbid anything happened to you and I, but it's our job with these really long-lived animals to make sure that they'll be okay in the next guardianship.
That's so important, because we think in terms of I'm okay with it, but it's like, maybe you are, but you may not be here. Like, you know, it, like you said, it's a little bit, you know, morbid, but we do need to think in terms of like something could happen to us at any time, or, you know, we might just get old and our, you know, long-lived bird is just going to outlive us. We need to make sure that we've set them up so that they're not going to bounce from home to home to home after we're gone. Because
that is so important. Those little skills, it's just a little skill. Your macaw's on you, and I love that, but you're putting a toy in there too. So we've got this ability to engage with toys and engage with shredding and engage with things other than the human. Slow baby steps. That's the other thing. These are baby steps. You're not going to get the macaw who's here onto a boing in the back corner in a week. It's not going to happen. You're going to do tiny little steps. We were talking before about how wonderful it is just to see a picture from a client where the bird's sitting on a stand. And it's been, I don't know how long for your clients, but it can sometimes take months for me to get a client back with a picture of a bird doing bird things on a bird location. I'm like, ah! Not today, not tomorrow.
It's probably been about a month for us, yeah.
Little pieces. And it's okay. It's not a linear process. I tell people it's not a death march. It doesn't have to always go towards the goal. We can make it fun, and we can play, and we can have good days, and we can have bad days. And if you're working on something like this and you have a plan, you're going to have a goal in mind. If you want help with creating a goal, talk to one of us. We're both, Lee and Robin, we're both available. If you're working towards a goal and you get a little speed bump, totally normal. Contact one of us again and we'll help you unspeed bump and get the things moving again. Because these are baby steps and they're little pieces towards that end goal, it can be really helpful to get a second set of eyes or a third set of eyes to figure out how to get you there.
Absolutely. I always say to clients that even like when I encounter a problem with my animals, that I'll often reach out and talk to other professionals, because sometimes we're so, you know, so involved, we're so much part of the environment, that taking that step back and seeing the environment as like a big picture can be really difficult for us. So we end up not being able to make those changes that maybe we need to make, and asking someone else, they can go, oh, you know what about this? And then we're like, I can't believe I didn't think of that. Like, So, yeah, so asking for help is such a big part of it. I was going to say something else. No, it's disappeared again. So Maria just wrote, the one with the blonde girl, she said, I think always what am I doing wrong? I have to say she's even thought about finding her a new home, but then thinking I'm worried no one will want her for the right reasons. They'll take her and they'll pass her on as she isn't an easy bird to handle, but she's the love of my life. So, yeah, it can be hard. And sometimes we, you know, I think bird people, like, you know, some of them, when I talk to bird people, we question our ability to provide appropriately for our birds more often than almost anybody else, like any other species people, you know, because we do. I think we all recognize that we're keeping these flighted animals in our homes. And so, well, you know, we feel guilty a lot about whether we're providing enough for them, et cetera, et cetera. Like even myself, like I know that I worry more about whether I'm giving enough to my birds than I do for my dog. And so
or my husband. Have I spent enough time with the, oh, I should probably spend some time with the husband tonight. Yeah.
So we do. And so, you know, and like I've got, you know, really good friends who are amazing, amazing parrot caregivers who still question whether they're enough for their birds. And so, you know, we are, you know.
We're most here to help. Whatever questioning it, let's talk about it. Let's always hold each other to a really high standard. I love that we're all asking this question because it means our birds are getting the best care.
Exactly. It's and that guilt that kind of pushes us to do better. Like,
you know,
that's the reason I spent $6,000 building 180 square meter netted space in my yard. Right. Like, because I was like, oh, I feel so guilty. Like, build more. And not everybody can do that, obviously, but, you know.
I've gone through the gamut of having, you know, my very first cockatiel when I was 16 years old and ye old cockatiel cage on only seed, and had that journey of providing, you know, varied diet and pellets and veggies and all of these things. And I think that we're all responsible for making our birds happy, healthy, best birds they can be, those natural behaviors, right? But we can also lift each other up and say, okay, where are you at right now? If you're feeling guilty, I get that. We all feel guilty. Where can we go? Where are you at? And how can we help each other, support each other, and grow a little bit? It's what I like to say is good, better, best, not good, bad.
Yes.
What you're doing is good. Is there better? Maybe. Is there a best? Let's look. But it's not good, bad, or bad person. Good, better, best. And we can support each other in that and make our birds' lives better. That's what we're all here for.
Yeah. So we're a little bit like, I mean, I didn't have a set amount of time, but I'm sure Robin has things to do. But just really quickly, we had one question that said the best way to desensitize my macaw. The bird has a large outdoor aviary where she spends her day, but if I take her for a walk on a harness, she can feel her anxiety. She currently just starting free flight training, but only indoor currently. Look, I am going to add that often harnesses do increase anxiety from my experience because they are aware that they are restricted by this item and now they're outdoors and outdoors is risky. I know that in our heads we're like, birds live outside. So outside they must love it out there. But birds that live, wild birds, their life is about being cautious because there are predators everywhere. And so your indoor bird understands the concept of predators outside as well. Outside is a big, scary place with lots of threats. And so being on a harness can actually make them feel more vulnerable. I think you'll find that your bird will probably be more comfortable in an aviary because they also understand the concept of bars. Yes, that's why when, like, sometimes we work with birds that are fearful of humans, having the bird in the cage can actually help the bird be more comfortable initially because they have that protection. In the same way that if you're looking at a tiger at a zoo, you're going to be a lot more comfortable if there's something between you and the tiger. And so I think you'll find that your bird that might be anxious on a harness outdoors will probably be more comfortable in an aviary outdoors. But you can also make sure that you go out initially in those early stages and sit with them. like make being in the aviary an activity that you do together while you help her build her confidence before leaving her out there for short periods by herself. And that way you can monitor her and make sure that she isn't feeling too stressed or panicked about it. And I wanted to answer this question because I think aviaries are a big part of having un-velcro birds.
I love having an aviary. My goal at some point in the future is to have an aviary that he can choose to go in and out of, say through a window.
Yes.
Right now it has to be in a crate, transported, and then into the aviary, which is taking some of that consent and control away from him. I also wanted to double check with this particular user. Is it the harness that's the anxiety? Is it the outside that's the anxiety? Which baby step can we narrow it down to and work on? Because we work from that place of safety. So if she's super comfy in her aviary, but not comfy outside in the harness walking around, what part is that? Which bit, where can we separate the little pieces? Could we put the harness on and walk around in the aviary where she's comfy and get that harness super, super positive? Can we go outside of the aviary, but like really, really short, really quick, really positive back in so that we're building it up in little pieces? Is it meeting all the strangers on the big long walk? Maybe we have a stranger's thing that things like, which part of this can we work on and which little piece is going to make the most success quickly? We have to start from success. So it sounds like you're right. She's got a little bit of anxiety, and anxiety is also a label. So some sort of not comfortableness out there. But let's go back to where she is comfy and build up again. Just so, like and that's, the harness training, just go back to where she's comfy and build it up again.
I find that's like that's probably one of the things that, and I teach a harness training course, and in that we like we really specifically talk about the need to desensitize the outdoors. It's not get the harness on, and then once you've got the harness on, you're taking your bird to Bunnings or you know hardware store. You're not going to the hardware store. You're not going to a cafe. You're teaching your bird that being on the harness is okay. You're desensitizing them to that. You might go and sit on your patio where there's a roof. For the first time you do it, and you might only go out for a couple of minutes and come back inside and take it off again. And then the next time you might, you know, go to the patio, but then do a little walk around your yard and then come back inside and take it. So many people get the harness on, they're like, let's go places. And your bird has never left their house or their aviary before, and that's the space that they know. And we take an animal out into this unknown environment. And we have to keep in mind that birds have home ranges. So wild birds have home ranges. They stick to those areas. They know them well. They know the predators. They know the trees. They know where they can hide to be safe. And so in captivity, those home ranges are inside our homes or inside their aviaries and the space that they can see around that. Taking them out of that space can be stressful for them. So you need to build it up slowly and let them get familiar with that outside environment. It's not a case of like once you've got the harness on, we can just take them everywhere and they're going to be okay with that. So desensitization is about taking it slow and building up from where the bird is comfortable. And so, yeah, if she's comfortable in the aviary, that's a great place to start with the harness. Harness in the aviary, harness just outside the aviary for a few moments, back in again and build up from there. So
100%. Yeah, there's so many bits and pieces that are hard to convey on text and chat that, I would have a ton of questions and we would just tease that apart to see exactly where we could make the most positive impact for that bird. And I think you've also seen with harnesses, it's not always you get the harness on and they're good forever. All harnesses are fine. They can have good days and bad days. You might have to go back to square one and retrain it. It might be poorly generalized, so it's fine in this situation but not in these other situations, and you have to generalize the behavior. There's a lot to it that could be the thing, so we're just throwing ideas out there, but you could definitely go back and set a plan, figure out what your goal is, and then do the little tiny baby steps so that you can work towards your end goal. Each one is worth time. Do the baby steps. Some of them are going to go real quick and some of them are going to take a bit of work. It'll be your bird that decides.
Yeah.
You know your bird. And share your plan with us. Share your journey. We want to see.
Yeah. Yes, yeah, that's it. And he did say that she got chased by magpies when she was younger. She got out. So that certainly would probably contribute a little bit, having had that. And I find a lot of birds that have been out are then a little bit more worried about being outdoors afterwards, because it is a scary place to be on your own.
They know it is.
You know, even if they don't get chased by magpies or something, it can be a scary place to be. So, yeah, absolutely. And sometimes it's I recommend to clients in my harness course actually taking the bird out, say, in a crate or something to some new locations, because, again, there's I'm in a cage. I feel safer because I'm enclosed. And then you can, you know, go to some of those new places in that way first. And when they're comfortable in that way, then we go back to the harness and get them out. And that can be a much more gentle way of getting them used to those environments.
Yeah.
Agreed.
Cool. Awesome. Well, we won't keep Robin for any longer. I'm sure it's getting to dinner time over there.
Yes.
For her and maybe for the birds. So we'll let you go. Thank you so much for joining us. That was amazing. Hopefully everybody's taken a lot away from that they can apply to their birds. And as Robin said earlier, make sure that you reach out to us if you have any, you know, speed bumps, roadblocks that you get caught up with working on this with your birds. Thanks everyone for joining us. Thank you very much for Robin for making the time to be here with us, and hopefully
thank
we'll
you
be
for
doing
having me.
Actually, Robin, really quickly before we go, Robin has a bird school and she does online courses that are available. Robin, do you want to tell people where to find that if they're looking?
Sure. The Canada Bird School is online 24/7, so it doesn't matter where you are in the world. We have presentations that are recordings of school. We have live schools once a month. We have online courses and we have behavior consultations. It's all at canadabirdschool.com. And you can come and hang out with us, join our Facebook page too. We would love to have you there. Our next live school is August 5th, the Thursday. Fifth or sixth, the Thursday at 5 p.m.
Thursday
my time, which is going to be 9 a.m. your time, the next day.
On Friday the 6th, yeah.
Okay. I'm doing a live class on why bird training makes you a better dog trainer. So if anyone here is a positive reinforcement dog trainer, you're going to really love some of the crossover stuff that happens. I'm also an IABC accredited dog trainer. I'm a KPA CTP dog trainer. And I love talking dog training in the context of bird training because there's a lot of similarities. So if you've always been interested in dog training, or if you are a dog trainer and kind of curious about this bird thing, come and join us. It's going to be a ton of fun, and it is live, so you'll have the ability to ask questions.
Awesome. Excellent. Cool. All right. Well, we'll let you go. Thank you so much again, Robin, and we'll talk to everybody soon. Have a great night, and for everybody else, have a great day.
Yes. Thank you. Yes.